For Ibn Khaldun, Islam in the form of Khilafa is God-guided and God-centered human association. It is the best way to the fulfillment of man's destiny, to the attainment of happiness in this world and in the next. Ibn Khaldun distinguishes three kinds of state according to their government and purpose. Government based on divinely revealed law, the ideal Islamic theocracy. Government based on a law established by human reason. And government of the ideal state of philosophers. The state as such is the natural result of human life, which requires association and organization. Human association is necessary. The philosophers express this in the saying, man is a citizen by nature. Mutual help is necessary to satisfy man's need for food, clothing and housing, and man must unite with many of his kind to assure his protection and defense. The provision of the necessities of life is followed by a desire for its comforts, and so the stages of food gathering and cattle raising are supplemented by the arts and crafts which provide better and more varied food, more comfortable houses and elegant clothes in the cities. Both rural and city life are necessary for the growth and development of civilization, the former being the natural foundation of the latter. But only a life of ease and luxury, the consequence of a well-functioning, differentiated economy, stimulates the will to power. To translate the will into reality requires the effective support of like-minded men, held together by a common bond, in the first place, the ties of blood and family tradition, which create a sense of solidarity and mutual responsibility, or a common outlook which shows itself in united action and serves as an important driving force in the formation of states and dynasties. Ibn Khaldun calls it asabiya, or group mind, and gives it as its aim dominion, rule. The evil inclination in man would inevitably lead to mutual destruction if there were not a universally recognized restraining authority in society, which is given force by the group mind. The state goes through five phases: conquest, build up of the dynasty, attainment of peak, decline and fall. Within four generations of a dynasty, it reaches its greatest power in the second generation, in which autocracy is usually achieved. The four generations of a dynasty are thus distributed over five phases of the state, which determine the characters of the citizens. The first phase, that in which the new group bent on dominion gains its objective and is victorious over its enemies. In this phase, the ruler is exemplary leader of his men to gain authority, acquire property, and defend and protect the gained territory. In the second phase, he becomes sovereign and alone exercises rule without his followers. He thwarts their endeavor to share the rule with him. The master of the dynasty strives to hire men, acquire clients and supporters in order to break the self-reliance of those who make his asabiya or group mind, and of his kinsmen who claim an equal share in the rule with him, until finally he consolidates the rule or in his own family, to whom alone he reserves the authority which he builds up. The third phase is the one of quiet ease and leisure to gather the fruits of rule and dominion, since human nature tends to acquire wealth and to leave behind fame. In the fourth phase, the ruler is satisfied with what his predecessors have built up, lives at peace with friendly and hostile rulers of his kind, and imitates his precursors as well as he can. The fifth phase is one of extravagance and waste. In this phase, the ruler destroys what his ancestors have brought together for the sake of lust and pleasure, for he is generous towards his intimates and liberal at his banquets in order to win. The scum of the people, whom he entrusts with great tasks which they are unable to undertake. In this way, he spoils his chances with the noble and distinguished among his people and with the followers of his predecessors. The state is like a natural organism, subject to growth, maturity, and decline. His whole theory is based on the fundamental distinction between a life of simplicity, courage, violence, and striking power, and a life of urban civilization in which these natural qualities are gradually submerged by the desire for peace and security, ease, luxury, and pleasure in the wake of autocratic rule. The absolute monarch can maintain his independent rule only through the weakening of that asabia by whose help he came into power. Since he must rely on an army to preserve order within and to protect his state against attack from without, the weakening of his supporters, originally animated by strong asabia, forces him to replace them by mercenaries. The prophet is primarily a lawgiver, the caliph. His successor is the ruler under Sharia, which bound together the people in the community of believers. It ruled supreme as the law of Muslim theocracy in the time of the first four caliphs. The decline of religion coincided with the transformation of Khilafa of the time into Mulk of Muawiyah and Umayyads. Urban life, guided by the restraining statutes of the Mulk, led to the gradual loss of courage and self-reliance due to the replacement of the restraining authority inherent in the Sharia by restraining authority of the state built on the power and conquest of a sovereign ruler. The distinction between Khilafah, based on divinely revealed prophetic law, and Mulk, founded on conquest, based on laws devised by reason and realized in the power state, is fundamental. Ibn Khaldun has correctly deduced that a weakening of the religious elan must strengthen the temporal component of the Khilafah and inevitably lead to its transformation into absolute monarchy in the form of the Mulk. On the other hand, religion, whether by prophecy or by call to its truth, is the source from which great empires spring. Transformation of the Khilafah into Mulk is natural and inevitable. At the same time, he is convinced that although the Mulk is capable of looking after the welfare of man in this world, even this is achieved more perfectly with the aid of the law of the Sharia. Therefore, if the Mulk is Islamic, it comes second in rank after Khilafah. The name Khilafah remained thanks to the continuance of Asabia of the Arabs. Khilafah and Mulk intermingled with each other in the two phases, but then the characteristics of the Khilafah disappeared with the disappearance of the Arabs, the destruction of the tribes, and the ruin of their affairs. It is therefore evident that the Khilafah at first existed without Mulk, then their character became intermixed, and finally the Mulk alone remained, isolated from the Khilafah at the moment when its Asabiyah became separated from that of the Khulafa. The transference of power from the Arab aristocracy to autocratic rulers in the Persian style, governing after the Persian model, is here explained in terms of decline of Arab solidarity and Asabiyah, and of Islam as a political driving force. In writing of the conditions which the caliph must satisfy, he insists on the descent of the Quraysh because of their powerful Asabiyah. Ibn Khaldun examines the criticism of Asabiyah that it consists of descent and pride of descent. He finds that Asabiyah properly applied is desirable provided it is directed towards truth and the cause of Allah. Ibn Khaldun, no less ready to acknowledge the theoretical authority of the Sharia, turned his attention to the state as it actually was. He stresses the support of the religion, of that religion, lent to Asabiyah, transforming a driving force originally based on descent or common material interest into an irresistible spiritual influence. For where otherwise rivalry and discord might threaten to disrupt the Asabiyah, religion unites all hearts, replaces the desire for the vanity of the world and its rejection, and turns men to God, seeking right and truth in unison.